this feeling in my bones. So good, I never felt this strong. And I can't hold it in no more. The truth will set me free, I'm sure. You got me feeling so good, and you know that I would. You got me feeling so good, and you know that I. You got me feeling so good, and you know that I would. You got me feeling so good, and you know that I.
Everybody, and welcome on into another edition of WWE's The Bump. We are fresh off the heels of the Elimination Chamber Perth and an unforgettable Monday Night Raw. 38 days until WrestleMania, and we are so glad to have you guys with us. I'm Megan Morant. He is Sam Roberts. Sam, this road has showed us anything. It is that the billing for the biggest WrestleMania of all time, it's going to live up to it. WrestleMania will certainly live up to this. What is your biggest, what storyline are you most intrigued by coming out of the chamber?
That's a big question.
Yeah,
38 days. It's crazy, by the way, when you put that number on it. 38 days.
I know.
Until WrestleMania. I mean, there was a lot going on with Gunther on Raw that had me intoxicated, but it's hard to look away from on the road to WrestleMania. Cody Rhodes, not only challenging The Rock, but that interaction that he had with Paul Heyman to close Raw on Monday, it was unbelievable. That's probably got me right now.
We are going to dive into all of that, but before we can do so, we got to get it out to Ryan Popola, because Ryan, social media has been going crazy after Chamber.
100%. The three of us are super intrigued on the road to this WrestleMania, and so is the entire WWE universe, including everyone here with us for the next hour. Get in on the conversation. How do you do that? Very simple. Hashtag WWE The Bump on Facebook, X, Instagram, YouTube chat. I'm in there with you for the whole hour, whether it's Maria, Grace Brown. I just saw Jeffrey Reimer in there. Get in on the conversation. You got questions. You got comments. We have two huge guests today. Megan, tell them more about it.
Maria, Jeffrey, shout out. Can't wait to interact with you guys on the show, but it is now time to let you guys know who are our guests on today's episode of The Bump. We have both winners of the 2024 Elimination Chamber match. One of the most accomplished women in WWE, the man here, not only to discuss her historic win, but her new book that is coming out in March. Of course, for the umpteenth time, Drew McIntyre will be joining us right here on The Bump, continuing his streak, most guest appearance on the show. Shout out, Drew. He's ready to contend for one of the biggest prizes in all of WWE. But as we mentioned off the top of the show, there's a lot going on. We got to break it down for you coming off Elimination Chamber, Sam. We're all looking forward to the Grayson Waller effect. We knew that Seth freaking Rollins and Cody Rhodes would be on that big show. But I'm not sure we were ready for what was about to happen. After taking care of business against Austin Theory, Cody Rhodes, he challenged The Rock for a match anywhere, anytime, and then Monday Night Raw, things got even crazier.
Yeah, well, we knew it was going to be big. We knew it was going to be the biggest Grayson Waller effect of all time, and it certainly lived up to it. And there was a time when challenging The Rock to a match anytime, any place was a little bit safer because you didn't see The Rock too often. But now we've got The Rock on SmackDown this week, as well as the SmackDown after that, and the SmackDown after that. Who knows when and if The Rock will show up to meet Cody Rhodes' challenge. But I don't think Paul Heyman was ready for the Cody Rhodes that we saw on Monday Night Raw.
No, Cody Rhodes in the main event against Grayson Waller. And then Cody hitting this Cody Cutter that would lead to the victory. But what transpired after the match is what has everybody talking.
Please withdraw this challenge from The Rock or else.
Or else what, Mr. Heyman? You want to know why I haven't rained holy terror on this microphone about your new boy, Dwayne? You want to know why I haven't trashed him in the media? It's simple. Myself, like almost everyone in here tonight, we were fans of The Rock. But I am done. I am absolutely fed up with being nice. If it's a bloodline setup, like I said, come and get me.
A defiant Cody Rhodes. Steel chair in hand. Unloading on Heyman's henchman. Crossroads.
The Roman Reigns. Call The Rock.
Because the bloodline isn't hunting me. I'm hunting the bloodline.
Hunting season, baby. Paul Heyman's got two phones. That's how you know it's serious.
Yeah. Man. He's got one for The Rock. He's got one for Roman Reigns. If they both want to talk at the same time, he's got it covered. He's got all the bases covered except what happens when Cody Rhodes stops being nice. He's been unflappable, this Cody Rhodes, looking good in a suit.
We're starting to see it a little bit.
A little bit?
Yeah.
I think a lot of it. You see the way he threw the chair at that guy? That suspended officer, as Paul Heyman described him? I couldn't believe the Cody Rhodes that we saw. And, you know, when people say they're going to go after the bloodline, every single time I've thought to myself, good luck. Good luck with that. Yep. Good luck with that, Chief. When Cody said it on Raw, I believed him. I believed Cody Rhodes.
You believed Cody Rhodes, and elsewhere on Monday Night Raw, Imperium, they came out to the ring. They were feeling very confident. Gunther, he had just defeated Jey Uso for the Intercontinental Championship, and the rest of Imperium was getting ready for a big matchup against the New Day, but then they would be surprised by this.
Who is going to be my opponent at WrestleMania?
You know, I hope you were watching this weekend, because at the Elimination Chamber, we ran the table. And we plan on doing the same thing at WrestleMania. Except we plan on adding more gold at WrestleMania. That includes that gold.
Gunther! When Dirty Dom and the Judgment Day say we're gonna do something, we mean it. And that means that title belongs to us.
All the power in WWE, and then of course this street fight between the New Day and Imperium would take place. Sam, we're so lucky that we get to watch greatness in the New Day.
I mean, this street fight was unbelievable. Did you see the way they smashed Francesca? They smashed Francesca like it was a table, answering the chants of the audience for Monday Night Raw. But yeah, the New Day, they took a lot of punishment, but we're seeing them evolve into the team they need to be in this new and improved WWE tag team division.
Imperium getting the victory, the New Day wearing jeans in the match, which
street
I thought
fight.
Was a very interesting choice. Yeah, ready
what
for
What are you
the
wearing
street? Jeans.
It's where they're having the fight.
I guess you're right, but speaking of an interesting choice, we gotta get to what you brought up on Raw Talk. We didn't really have the time to dive into it, but we have that time here. You said that Dirty Dom is the biggest threat to Gunther's Intercontinental title. Whoa. Let's just take a look at what you said on Raw Talk.
Prepared, huh? Receipts. I looked at that ring, and I saw the single greatest threat to Gunther's Intercontinental Championship reign when Dirty Dominic Mysterio stepped up to him. This is somebody who has improved more than anybody in the last year. This is somebody who has held.
Oh, come on. Oh, Dirty Dom, the biggest threat. What about Damian Priest, Mr. Money in the Bank?
He's
one of the most
too.
Dangerous people in WWE. Sami Zayn, he's a 6-time champion in WWE. And you see Dirty Dom as the biggest threat to the Intercontinental Championship?
I see Dirty Dom, our chicken tendy king, as somebody who has come out of the Mysterio legacy. You know how big that Mysterio shadow is?
Yeah,
and he has stepped outside of it and become bigger than his father Ray ever was. And now he looks right in the face at Gunther. And whether mommy thinks he can do it or not, mommy and Gunther are both about to get a rude awakening.
Well,
because you're looking at your next Intercontinental Champion.
Strong words by you, Sam Roberts. All right, Sam, you have the floor. Go
ahead. No notes. That sounded great. I'll tell you this. Here's my only thing that I would have changed. You did not sound great as a Dominic doubter in that clip. I mean, did you see the way Dominic stepped up to Gunther? You're talking about a man who has held the Intercontinental Championship longer than anybody in WWE history. You're talking about one of the most feared superstars that has ever graced the squared circle. And Dominic stepped right up to him.
He did.
Knowing everything that he has accomplished.
Well, you know, I just want to piggyback off. You said dark cloud?
I didn't say dark.
Rey Mysterio left a dark cloud?
I said shadow. I said dark. Shadows are dark, but I said shadow.
I mean, it's more like a sunshine path for Dominic here. All right, well, let's check in with Ryan. Ryan, what is social media saying about all this nonsense that Sam is saying?
What?
Well, it's interesting, Sam. I was going to start with tweets and posts that defending your theory. Couldn't find any. But so we're going to talk about Cody Rhodes instead on Monday. And a lot of people resonating with Cody saying no more Mr. Nice Guy, including here where they're saying that the bloodline pushed him too far. All in all, though, Cody Nation is ready. And but also, though, people are agreeing with Drew McIntyre. We're going to talk about this with Drew later, saying that Seth shouldn't be trying to help Cody along with the bloodline, that Seth has his priorities focused in the wrong area. But ultimately, as I said, Cody Nation is ready and everyone is bloodline hunting. We're going to talk with both winners from the Elimination Chambers here today, but a lot of people showed up and showed out at the Elimination Chamber, including Tiffany Stratton, who had everyone in the WWE Universe talking. What a performance by Tiffany. She stole the show. And then the Mighty here saying, Tiffany is a freaking star. This woman just swantoned off a chamber pod. She's amazing. Tiffany Stratton, yeah, she agreed. She thinks she's the center of the Australian Universe.
Does.
Who
well,
didn't? She is.
But who didn't like this Sam and Megan? That, of course, was Naomi and probably everyone else in the Women's Chamber other than Becky Lynch. She said, Tiffy time that behind is mine. That's to which peak. Tiffany, in very Tiffany fashion, just replied to that with a lot of kissy emojis. She doesn't seem too worried. But you know what? None of us should be worried about. None of us should be worried about what's happening on Raw with Regeneration X. Triple Tommaso Ciampa H asked R-Truth his signature, are you ready? And then things just took off from there. It was trending on X, as we will see here in just a second. There it is. It was trending on X. And then Johnny Gargano is even, he's got shirt ideas. Hey, WWE Shop, Regeneration X. Something to think about, something to stew on as we move forward here with Regeneration X, I think. Who knows?
Regenerate into something cool.
I'm excited about it. Make that shirt, WWE Shop. All right, you guys, it is now time to welcome on our first guest to WWE's The Bump, a woman that needs no introduction. She is the winner of the 2024 Elimination Chamber match. She will go on to WrestleMania, where she will face Rhea Bloody Ripley. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome on the man, Becky Lynch.
Becky.
Oh, hello. Hello there. How are you?
Oh, hello. Did we catch you in the middle of something?
It's best on my book here. Great content. Pardon me, I'll just put it aside now. There it is.
Oh, good spot. Good
Becky,
spot.
That's a great looking spot for that book, bestseller, and we're going to dive into that on this interview here on The Bump. But we got to get into this massive week that you had. How are you feeling after your big victory at Elimination Chamber?
Sore, very sore, but very accomplished. Very accomplished. Flew all the way up Perth to be true to my word. And for the last, since the start of the year, the big matches that I said I was going to win, I hadn't won. So this one meant a lot and put me on the right track to WrestleMania.
Now, Becky, set the scene for us. You are in Perth, Australia. You got over 50,000 members of the WWE Universe. You're inside this sadistic structure that just inflicts so much pain, and you're able to walk away as the victor. What was it like being there in front of Australia?
Oh, it was amazing. It was an incredible crowd. And, you know, it was the whole lead up into it. Like, everything that we did, everywhere that we went, the people were amazing. They were so excited. And with all that energy behind you, I felt like I couldn't lose, you know? And I got to hold the koala.
We absolutely love it. You got to hold the koala. And Becky, you're inside this sadistic structure that we talk about. And now you are moving on to face Rhea Bloody Ripley for the Women's World title. And you look at this moment here, looking out. Whoa. This with Liv Morgan, the manhandle slam. Can you describe the emotion you felt when you picked up the victory?
No, I don't think I can. And I think that's one of those things where when we have big moments like that, we're asked, like, how do you feel? And you kind of can't describe it because there's so much going on. First of all, you're in pain. Second of all, you're tired. Obviously, the jet lag is kicking in, and you know, you've flown on a 30-hour flight to get there, you haven't really slept, you've been busy, had media appearances, and then you've gone over 40 minutes in a steel cage with people trying to beat the bejesus out of you, and then you've got this adrenaline dump, but you also have this excitement of what's going to happen next, and there's the emotion, and there's everything else that's going on. It's hard to summarize into one emotion, because it's everything. It's so much going on.
What happens when we get past the emotion, when your body starts to catch up with you, right? Like you said, you're on a plane for 30 hours. You go into one of the most brutal matches that the WWE has to offer. You win / survive that. You get on a plane for another 30 hours. You get to Monday Night Raw. Nia Jax throws you a beatdown. How are you holding up physically after the beatdown on Raw?
Look, it ain't about how hard you hit. It's about how hard you can get hit and keep moving forward, and that's what I've done my whole career. But it's also, I got that Irish rage, man. You can't just hit me and think that I'm going to stay down and think that I'm not going to do anything about it. I'm going to get pissed. I'm going to come back. I'm going to beat the absolute crap out of you. And that's what I did that night. And I know Liv had some words for me. This is not something I say very often. I'm sorry, Liv. I have that Irish rage, you know. I have the rage and I have an impulse, and when it overcomes me, then I have to do something. And my child's running around in the background like a crazy lady. So if you're hearing that, well, she's adorable. So I'm not gonna apologize.
Yeah, I mean, I would imagine the Irish rage and that small little adorable child is something that you put up with quite a bit. But is that Irish rage? Is that what is fueling you to even have this match with Nia Jax? I mean, this is an important thing, I'm sure, for you to get done, but you're on the road to WrestleMania. You're trying to reclaim your throne, and before you can even get there next week, you've got this match with Nia Jax. Is it that important to you?
Yes. Yeah, look, have you ever known me, Sav, to take the easy way out?
No.
You know, And the other thing is, I won't be able to move on. I won't be able to move past and become the best version of me if I have that thing in the back of my head that says, Nia Jax got the upper hand, or Nia Jax beat me, or you couldn't beat Nia Jax. So these are the things that I have to overcome so that I can go on to beat Rhea Ripley.
So the match at day one, I think, is what we're referring to with that little voice that's been in your head reminding you of what Nia did. Has that match been with you the entire time?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah, no, because beforehand I said, look, there was this lie, you know, that Nia Jax created the man with the bloody face. And it is a lie, you know, like how many people have gotten bloody faces and not gone on to do the things that I've done. But I said, if I can't end that lie, then I need to end her, and I haven't ended it. So I need to do that before I take that title back. I have to.
The question is,
and then she's gonna keep doing it. You know, this is the thing. This is what Nia Jax is. She's a bully, right? You know. So if you don't stand up to her, if you don't end her, she's gonna keep doing this.
Yeah, and these are lessons that we have to teach the youth that are right there in your home, needing to learn the lessons. But the question is, how? Is there a new strategy? I mean, no spoilers, obviously. But have you figured something out that you didn't know going into day one that you know now that's gonna make it easier for you to win?
Do you think I'm going to tell that to you here publicly in front of everybody so that you'll hear it and then know what my strategies are? Come on now, man.
All right.
You tried.
Well, it's my job. I had to ask.
Yeah, you had to try.
All right.
All right.
Sam, valiant effort, Sam. And Becky, as we pivot to social, we're reminded that you, as the man, constantly have to pivot. Because before any of that went down with Nia on Monday, you came face-to-face with Rhea Ripley. A lot of things were said. Let's take a look at that right now.
You say that you're the backbone of this division. The man always thinks that they're the backbone of everything. But the funny thing is that behind every great man is a greater woman. But I'm not behind you, Becky, because mommy is always on top.
Becky, that struck a chord with a lot of people on social. There was a bunch of tweets I could have pulled. 2 days later, how do those comments sit with you?
I'm sorry, I wasn't paying attention.
Hi, Rue.
I wasn't paying attention because my little baby wanted to come on and say hi, and we couldn't tell her no. Do you want to say hi? Hi.
Hi, Rue. Hey,
good morning, everybody. What are you eating?
I'm eating a popsicle.
Yeah, you eating a mama popsicle?
That popsicle looks yummy.
This right here, this is what the man is fighting for. This is the legacy. This should be a threat, this visual, to Nia Jax, to Rhea Ripley. This is something to fight for, Becky Lynch.
This is it. I wasn't paying attention because I was concentrating on this little one, but this is my everything. This is what I fight for. And so when I said the man does it all, he does it all. She does it all. I'm doing this while I'm on the road 52 weeks a year, while I've been propping up the women's division, while I've been making everybody better. So if you think that Rhea Ripley is unbeatable, well, everybody's unbeatable until they're beaten. And I'm the one to beat it.
Absolutely. Now, Becky, I can't believe this is how we're going to transition, but we will. Because on Monday, you also called Dominic, quote, a dirty kumquat. And then had this incredible post on social. Now, listen, it was amazing. Everyone loved it. But to bring it to this road to WrestleMania, Becky, do you worry about Dominic and the Judgment Day overall as you are now on this path with Rhea towards Philly?
I don't think that I need to worry as much as Rhea needs to worry. Because when you look at half of her crew, half of them I have known for 22 years at this stage. Finn Balor trained me. I've known Jordan Devlin since he was a wee little lad. He couldn't even hit the top rope. He was only 12 years old when he started training. I remember his first day at training school. So I've known those two guys far longer than she has. And so you gotta ask, at the end of the day, are they gonna bleed purple? Or are they gonna bleed green?
Ooh.
Wow. Wow. All right, I'll just let that stay right there. And that's amazing though. One more pivot. You mentioned it earlier, you mentioned the Irish Rage, you apologized to Liv. She did say this to you after everything went down with Adam Pearce backstage on Monday. Not everything has to be about you. You apologize, which is amazing. Anything else you wanna add to Liv right now? The floor is yours.
Look, I know how I would feel. If somebody did that to me, I would be pissed. I would want to fight them. I understand that. If she wants to fight me, I'll never say no. But it was one of those things where, and I think this is even more on me, that I wasn't even thinking about her match. I wasn't even thinking about the match. I was just thinking about getting my hands on Nia Jax and retribution, because it was 2 weeks in a row. It wasn't just once, it was 2 weeks in a row, and I'm not just gonna sit back and take that. And so retaliation had to happen. But I do apologize that it was at the expense of Liv. Sorry, I could have handled that a million different ways. I didn't. If Liv wants to fight about it, she can. Or if she wants to cry about it, she can.
Oh, wow. Becky, I want to dive a little deeper into you and Rhea Ripley. Now, you said a couple weeks ago that Rhea might be better than you, and you need to prove that she's not. Can you pinpoint a moment when these thoughts that Rhea might be better than me started to materialize?
I think when there's this business goes in waves, right? It's always waves, and you're riding the momentum, and then sometimes it comes down, sometimes it crashes down. And then you're waiting to catch the next one, right? And you're looking up while you're in the calm of the sea, and you can see her riding this wave, and you can see everything that's being thrown at her, and you can see how young she is, and how naturally talented she is, and the finesse that she possesses in the ring, and so you're watching all of that, and you see how big she is, and you go, okay. Well, I'm a lot smaller than that, and I'm not natural at this. I never was, but I can outwork everyone, and I do outwork everyone. And so when you're nearly 20 years deep, kind of asking yourself, you know, am I still the best? Am I as hungry as I was? And the answer is, hell yeah, I'm better than ever, and I'm more hungry than ever. But when you're against somebody who has all those natural abilities, you know, you start to question yourself, especially when they didn't come so naturally to you. You know what I'm saying? But that's the thing that I have to remind myself, is it was never about being the most athletic or being a natural. It was always about heart and passion and work ethic. And that's never waned. And I don't think anybody can or ever will beat me in that. And that's the difference. But I need to prove to myself that I'm better than her.
I am fired up just listening to her. I'm ready to run through a wall.
You gotta be.
Yes.
And I think that's I was talking on my podcast on Monday. One of the things I think that for me makes this match so special is what it means for the division as a whole, not just today, but from a historical perspective. I mean, I feel like you took the women's division to heights that nobody had ever seen it or necessarily even predicted that it would go to. And then I would argue that Rhea Ripley took that baton and has continued to run. Based on what you've accomplished and the way you've seen the whole division grow, is there any part of you that steps outside of this and is actually proud of Rhea Ripley?
Yeah, I think a lot of me is. I think I'm proud of the entire division. But that's when I step outside. When I'm inside, I just want to slap the head off everybody.
It's great.
Rhea Ripley included.
All right.
I will be.
All right, Becky, grab that right behind you, because we are about to talk about your book that is coming out on March 26th, Becky Lynch, The Man, Not Your Average Girl. It's available for pre-order right now, but as I mentioned, available worldwide March 26th. It's been so fun to watch this process for you, because you just said it, you outwork everybody, but that's not just in the ring, that's with your daughter, that's writing a book, that's balancing all of the things that you balance on a daily basis. And now we're a month away from this book coming out. How are you feeling knowing that the world is about to get this thing in their hands?
I'm very excited, maybe a little bit nervous. There's a lot of truth in here. And you never know how people are going to take it, but that's not my responsibility. My responsibility is to write a book that I think is honest and engaging, and I think I've done that, hopefully entertaining, few laughs in there, maybe a few tears in there, and I'm proud. I'm proud of what I've put on paper. You know, it's been a life goal of mine. I grew up as a big fan of Mick Foley. It's one of the reasons that I never view my natural ability as a, or lack thereof, as a weakness, but you know, he's the person who taught me about having heart and about having passion, about not being your typical WWE superstar and how you can achieve anything. And then when he wrote a book, then I wanted to write a book. And luckily, I was able to bounce a bunch of ideas off of him. He really helped me throughout this whole process. And then we got some fine words of encouragement that are all written here on the back and on the inside. So John Cena loves it. Stone Cold Steve Austin loves it. I think you'll love it, too.
I mean, those are some of my favorite people right there. Those are words that I trust. And I mean, your story is so fascinating. I can only imagine when you get to share all of it. One of my favorite interviews I ever did was kind of going through your life leading to the WWE and before the WWE and everything that you did. And I know that part of the process of writing this book was going through old journals and finding old things you had written to kind of put those pieces together in the right context. What do you think was the most surprising thing that you found going through some of your old journal entries?
Not that it was surprising, but you can just, like, in the years that I left wrestling, and for anybody who doesn't know, I left wrestling when I was just 19 years old. I'd already, like, main evented in Corrigan Hall in Japan and wrestled all over Europe and America and Canada. And at 19, I felt like it was time to give up on my dream and be realistic and do a realistic job. And because at that time, what I'm doing now wasn't seen as possible. What I wanted to do was just not available for women. And a lot of people said it never would be. They were wrong. But in those seven years that it took from me giving up wrestling to coming back to wrestling, ending up in the WWE, you just see how much I would constantly be trying to convince myself that I was okay without it, you know, that I was fine, but it would just always come back. Like, it was really, it sounds so dramatic, but it was like coming to terms with a death. But then you find out that person isn't dead, and then you have to reconcile with, okay, now I get to have this whole new life again. It's very dramatic, but I think that was the most insightful things, because I felt like that, but when you see it written down on paper and you know it to be true, then it's a whole wild thing. The other thing is that I didn't really write down many stories. I just wrote down how I felt all the time. So I couldn't really tell you the details of things, but I could tell you how I felt about things. And I think that's a bit more important.
Now, Becky, once you arrived in WWE, obviously the WWE Universe has been with you every step of the way. And there's a lot of really cool opportunities for the WWE Universe as this book gets closer to releasing, including your book tour, which I'm sure you're incredibly excited for. I see so many people excited for it on social. How excited are you that once the book tour starts, and then even after the fact, being able to connect with your fans in new ways once they get more insight on your story and everything this book will provide them?
That's the best. That's why I'm doing this. And so being able to go out there and meet the people and have a chat and have some banter, take some photos, it'll be a party.
Most definitely. And then, Becky, today is the last day for entries to be postmarked in this contest that will see fans get a chance to get two WrestleMania tickets just by pre-ordering your book. Becky, I have to ask, you know, your book is coming out. You're on the road to WrestleMania. In the best possible way, is your head spinning as all of this kind of culminates towards the end of March and beginning of April?
I think this is when I'm actually at my best, when I have so much going on that I can't think, because as we've seen in the past, like, for example, when Nia broke my face, you know, and I came back and beat everybody up, when I'm running on instinct, when my subconscious is doing the work, it turns out that my subconscious is one hell of a fighter too. And so I think when I can't let my head get in the way and it's all heart, it's all passion, it's all instinct, that's when I do my best work.
Well, Becky, when I think of the man, you, Becky Lynch, I think of pure heart and pure passion. And that's exactly what this book is. And you, not only did you write it all yourself, but you did the audiobook too yourself. Why did you make the decision to record that, and what was it like reading the words that you wrote for the audience?
Because I thought I had too much free time and I needed to do something. I feel like it's a better listening experience if you are hearing the person who wrote it read it. So you're hearing me tell my story in my own words. I thought that would be a better experience for the audience. And so that's why I wanted to do it. And how was it reading? Sometimes it was quite difficult. There's a few difficult passages in there for me to read. And so that was hard, and that would have to, you know, I'd have to compose myself, and it would take a minute here and there. But it was great. It was a great experience. At some point, it felt like I was being waterboarded with my own words, just because, you know, you're staring at an iPad for 6-7 hours a day reading what you wrote. And so sometimes you kind of, your head and your mouth start to disconnect almost. But it was great. It was a great experience.
Later on today, we've got a guest coming on The Bump named Drew McIntyre. He's waiting in the wings. Drew McIntyre has a match at WrestleMania against the world heavyweight champion Seth freaking Rollins, which you may have some insight and investment in that's unique to your household. Is there anything that you think that Drew McIntyre should know today going into WrestleMania?
I can't curse on this.
No.
I will say he's screwed. You're screwed, Drew.
Oof.
I love you, but you're screwed.
Tough for Drew.
Becky, thank you so much for taking the time out of your busy life to chat with us. Any final words for Nia, Rhea, Liv Morgan, anybody in the WWE universe? Yeah, Drew, too.
Good luck. You're going to need it. Oof. Also, buy my book, available for pre-sale right now. Comes out March 26th.
I love it.
Becky, thank you again so much, and we'll see you next time.
Adios.
So much fun chatting with Becky Lynch. We talked a lot about WrestleMania, Sam, and something fun going down at WrestleMania is a new WWE world. This is a new one-of-a-kind experience for fans. It starts Thursday, April 4th. It's going all the way to Monday, April 8th, located in the Pennsylvania Convention Center in Philadelphia. How do you get tickets, Sam?
You go and get them right now at fanaticsevents.com/WWE. Look, this is what WrestleMania is all about. Of course, WrestleMania is WrestleMania is WrestleMania. But people ask me about the WWE taking over cities like Philadelphia. And WWE World is what it's all about. When you can just get WWE fans, all of us, all together, and you can see the memorabilia, you can touch it, you can meet the superstars.
There's going to be live shows.
It is the funnest thing you can do while you're in Philadelphia for WrestleMania.
Ryan, you cannot miss WWE World. Am I right?
Absolutely. We are all incredibly excited for WWE World. But you know what else we're all really excited for? WWE Superstar Sunday on A&E. It is back. Let's get into it. WWE Superstar Sunday on A&E is back, and it's where unrivaled storytelling reigns supreme. This week, we have a new episode of WWE Rivals, as this episode tackles the era-defining conflict between Jake the Snake Roberts and Macho Man Randy Savage, which will be immediately followed by WWE Legends. And this week's legend is none other than Sergeant Slaughter. That's this Sunday starting at 8 on A&E. Let's take a first look at this weekend's upcoming episodes right now.
Randy and Jake, two of the greatest performers that ever walked into a ring.
Jake the Snake Roberts.
When they went together, you know it's going to be magic.
WWE Rivals.
No two guys could do it better.
From the table.
And then WWE Legends.
He is a certifiable legend.
Shut up, you maggots!
It means everything to me, and it cost me a lot of things.
WWE Superstar Sunday. New episodes Sunday at 8, only on A&E. Watch next day on the A&E app.
Can't wait for both episodes, but like we did last week, we thought for Rivals, we'd put up a little poll on our Bump X account and ask, Who were you siding with back in the day? Were you team Macho Man or were you team Jake the Snake? As you can see behind me, a pretty lopsided result, and the winner was Team Savage with a big victory ahead of Rivals this Sunday. Sam, I'm sure you're probably none too pleased that Team Roberts was a little fell a little short there.
I think that that's not quite fair to Jake the Snake. I think people might have gotten confused and voted against Team Roberts. For other reasons,
yeah, because of all of this dirty Dom, this dirty Dom.
It might have been a vote against Dirty Dom, Sam. It might have been a vote against Dirty Dom.
It could have been.
Who would vote against Dirty Dom?
A lot of people.
Watch the product. He's incredible.
All right, well, it is now time to welcome on our next guest on WWE's The Bump. He's the winner of the 2024 Elimination Chamber match. And he has earned himself a World Heavyweight Championship match against Seth freaking Rollins at WrestleMania. He's also been on The Bump more than any other WWE superstar. So thank you so much for that. Welcome, Drew McIntyre. Oh my goodness, you are in the woods, in your natural element. We have so much to talk with you about, Drew, but first and foremost, let's do a temperature check. How are you doing after everything that went down this week?
My temperature check, I'm pretty cold. It's a little rainy out here. I'm at one of my properties where I come to escape, to think, but thanks to the marvels of modern technology, I can't escape very far. So I'm still talking wrestling, and I'm glad to be, because it was a hell of a week for Drew McIntyre.
Now, I'm a little concerned. You had mentioned that you were dealing with some issues with your eardrum. How are you feeling health-wise?
Deaf. I'm going to need you to speak up. Nothing is going to affect me. Nothing's going to take me out of WrestleMania, like I said on Monday, like I said to the doctor. You know, I might be hurt, but who do you think I am? CM Punk. It's not going to take me out the game. But yeah, it's been a little frustrating. My hearing isn't the best in general. So to get my eardrum perforated, to hear even worse than I do in general, it is really annoying. I think it's been my eyesight even better somehow, though. My other senses are heightened.
Oof. That's dangerous. And it's one of the things I think that makes you potentially the savior of WrestleMania. You know, we've gone on so...
Potentially.
We'll see. It's the savior of WrestleMania. You're right. Look, we've gone on so many rides with you from an emotional perspective. We've seen you at WrestleManias. We've seen you at Royal Rumbles. We've been a part of this entire journey. But this is a different Drew. This is all business Drew. This is logical Drew. You're not so in your feelings, maybe, as you used to be. When you were in that Elimination Chamber match and you were popping your eardrums and you were doing everything that you needed to do to make sure that you won that match, and the bell rang and they announced your name, what was the emotion that you were feeling? What was running through your veins?
Everything's going exactly to plan. Everything's going exactly how it needs to go, not just for me, but for Raw, for WWE as a whole. And my God, my body hurts. I was pretty much the biggest guy in there. Obviously, Randy's huge and Lashley's huge, but somehow I ended up taking the giant falls, the pop-up power bombs, the DDTs on the floor, Logan Paul leaping 15 feet from the pod onto my face and neck. But inevitably, I overcame. And some people might say, oh, Drew, there's this reason and this reason. I don't control anybody's personal issues. I focus on the task at hand. I've got to keep my cool head in amongst the chaos, and that's exactly what I'm doing these days.
Yeah, and you've been doing it a lot, and I've noticed that. You've seen the situation that you're in, and when there's an advantage to take, you take it, and you've won a lot of matches because of it. But something that struck me as a fan, watching at home, the voice of the WWE, Michael Cole, on more than one occasion, has gone out of his way to directly call you a hypocrite for taking advantage of interference, including bloodline interference. Does that bother you when Michael Cole says something like that? How do you respond?
Yeah, it bothers me a lot.
Yeah.
But Michael Cole specifically, but Pat and anybody in commentary, you know, they are the voices of WWE. Michael is the voice of WWE. He controls the narrative. He affects exactly how the fans think and feel. And he's painting me with this negative brush, and I can't swear on here, but it pees me off. And I feel like I'm being attacked. And if I don't have the appropriate time on the show to say how I feel about Michael because I'm focused on something else, I have to go to social media to get the truth out there. And I will get the truth out there. My real fans see the truth, and slowly but surely, everyone's coming round to the truth. And I'm playing a long game here, and the truth always comes out, and I am absolutely not a hypocrite. I'm doing absolutely what needs to be done for Raw, for the world title, for WWE. I've been doing this thing my whole life. I've been doing it 20 years. Look at all the ups and downs in my personal journey. If anybody knows what's good for this place, it's Drew McIntyre.
Drew, you mentioned social. As you opened your phone yesterday and opened up social media, you had to see a certain video. You mentioned him a moment ago. It was from Logan Paul. Let's take a look at that right now.
I want to take a moment to say thank you. You don't achieve success alone.
No, you don't, Drew, and you didn't.
I was the first man in that chamber, the last man standing.
Hey, that's crazy, bro, because this is how I remember you finishing the match. And this is how I finished the match. Looks like I'm standing. In fact, the last time I remember you standing, you were under me.
Because of you, this happened.
That's all I wanted, Drew, a little recognition for helping you win. Because let's not forget who knocked out Randy Orton that allowed you to win. Yeah, buddy, it was me. And I did it because I saw that you drank Prime, and I appreciate that. Thank you, Drew. Congrats.
So, Drew, yet another attack. Now, you did respond on social yesterday. You said, quote, I see your brother got all the talent and the brains. Admittedly, it's a very low bar. But with this forum here, Drew, you know, we always like to provide you a forum. Do you care to elaborate at all on these thoughts or anything in relation to Logan Paul's video?
Well, I appreciate Logan taking the time to make a video. He has a huge fan base, which puts my name across his huge fan base. He's obviously very talented at putting videos together. So it was a nice little video to watch, but I suggest if you come at me on social media, you're prepared for my responses because I'm unleashed. I've been holding back for a few years now, but I'm not holding back anymore. So you're taking a huge risk if you come at Drew McIntyre, and that was me being gentle in my response.
Wow. All right, let's talk about you being unleashed. You had a lot going on Monday, but when you hit the ring, what you started with was sitting in a very familiar way that someone else sits. And then when talking about CM Punk, there were so many posts I could have pulled like this one, the GTM, go to Mania. Your thoughts on Punk and his thoughts on you are well established. This is not coming from me or us at the Bump, but Drew, how do you respond to people that in light of everything that Punk is going through, that you are being too harsh in your attacks of him in recent weeks?
Too harsh? And I think Punk and everyone should be thanking me, all his fans should be thanking me, because I'm the one keeping him relevant right now by constantly talking about him. Not only that, I've dedicated my win at WrestleMania, the world title match, to Punk, so if anything, I'm the good guy here. Oh. I don't see the issue. Should be thanking me. Send me gifts, Punk.
Oh. Amazon wish list, perhaps. All right, fair enough. Now, one more. This is a thing that I've seen come up a few times on social, including here from Verb. He says, gotta wonder why Drew McIntyre seems to be the only one who has a problem with CM Punk at this point. Have you seen those comments, and how do you respond to that type of ideology?
The only one that seems to have a problem with him because he's been gone, he's hurt. When he was there, there was lots of people with problems with him, but now that he's not there, I'm the only one keeping his name alive, so that's why if he was there, there's a crap ton of people that have a problem with CM Punk, trust me, even if they're not saying it publicly.
Oof. Whoa.
Okay, Drew, before we talk about that conversation you had in the ring on Monday night with Seth freaking Rollins, we got to go to a conversation you had backstage on Monday night with Jey Uso. Let's take a look at that right now.
Now I'm in a good place, I'm riding high, and I felt like we needed to have this chat. I can relate to what you're going through, and I want you to know from the bottom of my heart, you deserve this.
Drew, you're laughing. You're laughing about everything that went down, and you do have a match against Jey Uso next week on Monday Night Raw. Do you have a message for him?
Yeah, it's pretty simple. It's the same thing I've been saying for months and months and months. Where's my apology? How long have I asked for an apology? All I've wanted from Jey, the same thing he gave Randy, the same thing he's given everybody else except Drew McIntyre, when him and his family literally ruined my life for a period, ruined my huge moment in the UK. The reward to my family for all the sacrifices was going to be that heavyweight championship. And I'm never going to forget that. And the least he could do is give an apology. It's been so long now, even someone as thick-headed as Jey could go, oh, yeet, maybe I should apologize to Drew and maybe things will be fine. But no. So if he's going to treat me that way, I can treat people a whole lot worse. If you got in my bad side, you've learned it's not a good place to be.
Now, Drew, before you came on the show, we had Becky Lynch on. I don't know if you caught any of it, but we did ask her about how you were facing Seth freaking Rollins for the World Heavyweight Championship. We asked her if she had a message for you, and she said point blank that you're screwed. So now that you've had a little bit of time to digest everything that you and Seth talked about in your ring, what are you thinking about Seth, and what's your biggest takeaway from everything that he said?
First of all, obviously Becky's got to say that when she's on camera. We saw each other off camera briefly, and she was like, Drew, you know, I've got to say that, but, you know, I'm the man of the house, and it'd be pretty cool for two Celtics to be successful at WrestleMania, big Celtic invasion at Mania, so, you know, do it for the lads. But that was off screen. But when it comes to Seth, I mean, I told him exactly how I felt. You know, stop fighting battles in other lands, battles that are nothing to do with you. Focus on your people. Focus on Raw. Focus on the world title. You're getting lost in the background, to be honest, over there. And I believe he's doing it for selfish reasons, egotistical reasons. And I made it very clear how I feel. When I'm world champion, I will not give a darn. I can say damn on this show. I'm trying really hard not to swear today. I don't give a damn what's going on in SmackDown when I'm world champion. I didn't enunciate my words clearly. I guess Pat reacted on the show. But what I said was, if SmackDown's on fire, I do not care if they're on their knees begging for my help. I would not pee on them to put that fire out. My responsibility be for my people on Raw. And it's that simple. And I understand his argument. He's trying to put together some Avenger team or something. If you look up that one scene with Wolverine when he's asked, you know, to assist in the battle and his reaction, that's pretty much where Drew McIntyre's at if you're asking for my help.
I understand what you're saying there, and I do. I feel like you're composing yourself very well here. I feel like Megan and Ryan are sneaking in shots at you, and I don't really appreciate it as somebody who's a big fan of yours. So I'm going to try to bring it back to a more together.
I was just telling him what Becky said.
Well, both of you are playing the what do you say to people who say game. And either way, Seth Rollins talking about the bloodline on Monday Night Raw. You made yourself clear about how you feel people shouldn't take care of other people's problems. But when Seth is talking about going directly at the bloodline, trying to cut the head off the beast that has haunted both of you and many others, is there any part of that that you can relate to and understand and think that there is some logic to it?
In the past, absolutely. Because I guess I was thinking the way Seth's thinking right now, that I've got to fight everybody's battles. I've got to take care of everybody else's business rather than focusing on my own business and what is most important for WWE or what's the most important task at hand. And to me, all that matters right now is Raw. All that matters right now is the world title. And Seth's done such an amazing job with it. He took it from nothing, raised it like his own, gave it the tools to succeed, and took it as far as his body will let him. And he wants to go fight these battles when he's literally falling apart. And it's my responsibility, as far as I'm concerned, to take that title from him and take it to the next level and make it the number one title in WWE. It's already the title everyone wants to fight for. I said it already, you know, to Seth, to Cody. You know, most people don't want to fight Roman for the title because they know the bloodline will interfere. They know what the end result is. They want to come for the working man's title, the workhorse title. And unfortunately for Seth, like I've also told him before, if he was a real workhorse, they would have shot him dead after the first injury, never mind the countless others that have happened. So a great job he's done. Thank you, Seth. We'll always remember you, but I'm taking it from here.
So on that note, taking it from here, taking the title from Seth Rollins, you, if one watches your performance on Raw, every single week you get better and better on SmackDown too, whether it's qualifying for the Chamber, whether it's beating Cody Rhodes. But you have had opportunities at Seth Rollins before. You've come out on the short end of the stick, be it at Crown Jewel, be it at Day One. What is different right now? What makes WrestleMania a spot where a different result can happen?
Well, the first match, as I've talked about, you know, I hesitated in there with Seth at Crown Jewel. I had sympathy for him. I knew how much pain he was in. I knew how much that title meant to him. I'd seen him, you know, with his family, with his daughter, and I just wanted to let him know what a great job he's done in the match. What an idiot I am. That was on me. You can't do that with somebody like Seth Rollins, and it cost me. I had to learn just to hit the kill shot the second you see the chance, no matter the circumstances around you. And as we've seen recently, I've learned to do that. No matter what's going on around me, I focus on the task at hand. That's what I learned from that match. The second match, that idiot, Damian Priest, I don't know how many times he tries to cash in the worst situations possible. So that's my biggest thing right there. That's what cost me last time, is to keep my eyes on Priest, maybe lock him in a room, maybe beat him down before the match, because the guy doesn't wait to the most appropriate situation, which would be when the match was over, once I'd beaten Seth and I was prone and I was hurt and I was at my weakest. Why come in halfway through the match when both of us are on fire? Then a claymore on the floor, which hurts me just as bad as my opponent, and then that costs me the match. So that's the X factor right there, is I need to take out Priest, because I know 1,000%, just like I've done in the past, like I beat Seth Rollins one-on-one, and right now there's nobody hotter than Drew McIntyre, and I'm also 6'5" and 280 pounds and a pretty bad man on top of it.
Drew, as we bring it to social fan questions, and that was absolutely electric right there. There was one fan question that we got over and over again. I would be remiss if I did not ask it.
Why is Drew so sexy?
Yeah,
that was mine. That was mine.
In addition to that one, Sean and many others wanted to know, as we're on this road to WrestleMania, WrestleMania itself, do you think we'll hear Broken Dreams at any point?
Wow, that's the first time I've ever heard that question. Ever? I get that question literally every day. I'm not exaggerating. Every single day, be it social media, be it in person, or every interview I do, which is countless. I've always asked about it. We had a little tease at Clash of the Castle. The cool thing about it was the fans sang along, as I knew they would, because I've talked about it for so long. And I always tell everybody, you know, learn the lyrics to Broken Dreams, because when it happens, you better know them. It's like, you know, what's the Cody thing? You better get ready to learn the lyrics to Kingdom. So you better get ready to learn the lyrics to Broken Dreams, because when it does happen, and it'd be cool if we get a little teaser at Mania. I don't know if it suits the character right now, if it suits me right now. I love the war drums, but just instead of tagging me, start tagging Triple H constantly. You know, he's made it very clear on the show that he's the man in charge, so tag his arse to death. Say we want a version of Broken Dreams, and I'm sure it will happen.
Now, Drew, you mentioned Cody there briefly. He kind of relates to this question, a very simple question from Lena, who asks, how does it feel knowing that you will finish your story in front of live fans at WrestleMania?
Whoa. It was pretty good. And it wasn't an easy journey to get here. It's been a rough couple of weeks physically, mentally. I'm still suffering the jet lag, but I can finally see the finish line. I can finally see WrestleMania. I can finally see getting the title in front of live fans. And I mentioned before, you know, those first two reigns, very important to me, very essential for the time. And probably the proudest work of my career, because I know how scared people were, how much they were suffering, because I was talking with them, not just on the internet, but in live chats, etc. And I'm very proud of those reigns, but they were for everybody else. This reign will be for me, will be for my family, and will be for CM Punk in front of live fans.
Drew, with all of that being said, do you have anything you want to leave the WWE Universe with 38 days ahead of WrestleMania and ahead of your big matchup with Jey Uso on Monday Night Raw?
I just want to say thank you. I always want to say thank you. I'm so appreciative for my fans that have been with me since I started in WWE at 22 years old. Came with me through the ups and downs, stood by my side, and I'm grateful for the new fans that have got on board, the true fans that stuck by my side when they didn't understand, you know, the changes that I was going through and what I started to see clearly, quite frankly. And now it seems like a lot more people are getting on board, and it's okay if you're a little late to the party. You're starting to see if anyone's going to push WWE into the future, Raw into the future. It's clearly Drew McIntyre, and everybody's welcome to join the party.
Drew, thank you so much for the time. We'll let you get back to the nature that you are enjoying, and best of luck as we head down this road to WrestleMania.
Heck yeah. Appreciate you as always. And yeah, what number is this?
Up team.
18. I believe it's 18.
18. Not good enough. I'll be back soon.
Oh, we cannot wait. Thank you so much, Drew, for joining us. What a fun episode of The Bump. Thank you to Becky Lynch. Thank you to Drew McIntyre. Lots to unpack from all of that, Sam.
Yeah, Drew showing up looking like a dark Jedi and sounding like one, too. Scary stuff.
And Sam, I know I wanted to give you some time to have a few words before we came on the air today. It was the passing of a WWE superstar that meant a whole lot to a lot of people, but especially to you.
Well, yeah, a lot of people for sure, of course. Virgil we lost. Virgil was a big part of my radio show, but before that, my childhood and a lot of us, whether it was winning the $1 million championship at SummerSlam 91, SummerSlam 92 at Wembley Stadium, joining the NWO, and everything he did in between. Such a big part of the $1 million man, Ted DiBiase, as well. Today we say rest in peace to an absolute legend and huge part of all of our childhood, Virgil.